Welcome to the first video of the third chapter of this course. In this week, we will learn how to realize a PV module starting from the solar cells. Then we will discuss the electrical properties of the module. After this introduction video on the basic design rules and how to read the datasheet, we will immediately start to compose our module beginning from solar cells. We will see the most updated structures, as well as materials and the interconnection techniques that are employed in photovoltaic industry. Now, let's have a quick overview of the entire design process of a PV system. The first step is to calculate the energy consumption of the loads, which is usually called the load profile. Thus, we need to know on a daily or a weekly basis what is the energy required by the loads. This survey should be done for every day of the year because the appliances might have different usage in winter and in summer. Then we have to choose the type of PV system. Basically, this choice is between a grid-connected system and off-grid PV system. As we have already seen, grid-connected and off-grid PV systems use different electrical components. However, in both configurations, we have the PV modules, which generate electricity. There are many types of modules to choose, and this has mostly to do with how much area is available. Of course, the smaller the available area is, the biggest the constraints are, because we have to likely deploy the most powerful modules. On the other hand, when we have a lot of area available, the choice is wider, enabling less powerful modules that can be also be more cost-effective. In the end, the optimum solution is a trade-off between energy requirements and the different location-dependent situations. If we want to use batteries for storage purposes, we also need a charge controller to monitor the energy flows between the batteries, the modules, and the loads. It will also protect the batteries, avoiding overcharging and overvoltage, which can reduce their performance and lifetime. Next step is the selection of the batteries between the lead-acid technology, which is still the most widespread, and the newer lithium-ion technology. It is not finished, because if we want to power AC appliances or we want to supply the power to the grid, we also need a DC to AC inverter. Depending on the size of the system, either one-phase or three-phase inverters exist. All these components are connected by means of cables, and since they have a certain resistivity, the thickness has to be investigated as well with some calculations. Of course, the shorter the cable is, the lower the resistive losses are, which are included in the system losses. Each bullet will be further investigated in the coming videos. For now, I want to show you how to read and where to find interesting data about the properties of a PV module. Thus, let's go together through a typical PV module datasheet. This is how a datasheet looks like, and here as an example we have a module by Panasonic based on heterojunction technology. This highlighted part is on the top right of the datasheet and deals with the dimensions and weight. Especially the first are important information for calculating the module area and thus the power incident on the surface when the irradiance is known. Starting from the left-hand side, we have front, side and back views including the frame and the junction box, which is represented by the little square on top of the back view with the connectors attached to it. Underneath the figure, there is the weight, that is 15 kilograms in this example. Let's move to another box, the one below this section. Here it is written the warranty strategy, which varies depending on different brands. For example, you can see the standard tiered warranty that ensures a power output of 90% of the minimum power output for the first 10 years and 80% for 25 years. Then, the various materials composing the modules are listed from the solar cells, which are heterojunctions with the intrinsic thin layer encapsulated in anti-reflection glass, to the frame that is realized in aluminum. Last part deals with the standard certificates, which we will see in more details further on. Now we have the dependence on the irradiance. These are the voltage current characteristics under different irradiance conditions, but at a constant temperature of the solar cells, that is 25 degrees centigrade. Note that usually the different levels of irradiance are realized with the same light source. In this way, to reach a specific irradiance value, light is dimmed by means of filters. As you might notice, fixing the temperature, the current increases with the irradiance, starting from more than 1 ampere when the irradiance is 200 watt per square meters to a value almost 6 times higher when the irradiance is 1000 watt per square meters. Finally, we are going to see the most important and interesting part of the datasheet where the electrical data are listed. First of all, it is important to notice that these electrical data are subdivided into 4 groups. The table on top gives the results at standard test conditions, or STC. Then, the temperature characteristics follow. The third table gives the result of normal operating condition. And finally, the last one is under low irradiance conditions. Let's see what STC means. In the relevant table, electrical parameters characterized in this test are listed. During the standard test condition, the temperature of the cell is kept constant at 25 degrees centigrade. The irradiance falling on the module is 1000 watt per square meter, considering the AM1.5 solar spectrum and wind velocity 0. However, when PV modules are operating in the field, they are typically at higher temperatures than 25 degrees centigrade and at somewhat lower insulation conditions. Therefore, in order to determine the power output of the solar cell, it is important to first determine the nominal operating cell temperature, or NOCT. This is defined as the temperature reached by open-circuited cells in a module when the air temperature is 20 degrees centigrade, the integral of the solar spectrum AM1.5 gives 800 watt per square meters, and wind velocity is 1 meter per second. In this example, the NOCT is 44 degrees centigrade. Having defined both STC and NOCT, we can now focus on the electrical data, which are the power, the voltage and the current at the maximum power point, the open circuit voltage, and the short circuit current. In STC case, also the maximum current and system voltage are reported for safety, as well as the production tolerance power. This last parameter specifies the range within a solar cell will either overperform or underperform its rated power P at STC conditions. I already anticipated that the second table gives the temperature coefficients of maximum power, open circuit voltage, and short circuit current. They are very important since the temperature of the solar cell has direct influence on the power output of the PV module. In fact, as you can see, high temperatures increase the short circuit current, but decrease both the voltage and the maximum power achievable. To summarize, in this video we have introduced the rules for designing a PV system and we have learned how to read a PV module datasheet. In the next video, we will give you more information about the PV modules available in the market. In this way, you will be able to perform the best selection of the solar module for your PV system.